Welcome to another inspiring message with Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa, as she brings you a word from God.
Displace every other thing. Take the first place. Take the first place. Take the highest place. Displace every other thing. Take the first place. Take the highest place. Displace every other thing.
Amen. We just worship you right now, Lord, and we thank you that your word does not go empty or void, but that your word says in Isaiah 55 that it always returns. It always returns having accomplished your purpose. And so we thank you right now, Lord, that you will speak to our hearts, I pray, against every distraction that would steal the word from us. And I ask you right now, Holy Spirit, that you would fill us, that you would, Lord, just speak to each of our hearts this morning. I pray for your anointing. Holy Spirit, come. Come in power, Lord. Come in power, anointing. Come and fall upon your people this morning. We're hungry for you, God. We're hungry for you, Jesus. We need you more than anything in our lives. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Aren't those just amazing, awesome, awesome words of faith when you hear people stand up and speak about what God has done in our lives? It's no small matter. It's so easy in hindsight to go, oh yeah. But in the time where a person has had to hang in for faith and wait on the Lord, it's not. But the Lord reminded me the other day that there were many things and showed me the many things that God has been doing in my life personally over the last 23 years since I recommitted my life to the Lord, over 2 decades ago. The devil wants to remind you of all the bad stuff. You know, he wants to keep telling you about what you've done wrong. He wants to keep, and I'm not saying don't be accountable. Of course, we're accountable for our wrongdoing. That's why so many people, when they leave the church, leave because they take offense. They never prepare to look at their own stuff. They never prepare to look at their own lives. Everybody else is always wrong, not them, right? Doesn't that remind you and ring of sin? When we're not prepared to ever take responsibility for our own wrongdoing. Amen. And it's everybody else's fault. And so the devil wants to remind you, though, on the other side of things. He wants to remind you of everything that's bad in your life, everything that you do wrong, everything that hasn't come to pass. But God wants to remind you of the good things. God wants you to think, if you just take a few minutes right now and you think, since you've been attending this church, or even before that, if you've been a Christian, a born-again believer, and you've actually been worshiping and serving the Lord before you came here, just think back a couple of years and just think about how God has touched your life. Think about all these things, the miracles that God has brought into your life. Think about when you've had sickness. Think about when you've had that last 10 rand. Think about all of the things that God has come through for you for. Amen? There are many things. There are many, many things. And when we look at it, we can turn around and say, that has built my faith. Because the enemy wants you to forget. But God wants you to remember so that you can see what is to come. See, I always bring the cross into my speaking, not because I'm an evangelist, but because the cross holds power. Amen? And I speak because we understand that if Christ didn't want change in our lives and transformation right here on earth, not just the one day in heaven story, then Christ would not have had to come. Amen? Because you don't have to be transformed without Christ's power. So it's through Christ that we are transformed. And that transformation is a supernatural work. It's the restoration of the human being to the original intent. Amen? And I've called my sermon, called with divine intention. Some of you are waiting for turnaround part 2, but I have to do what the Lord calls me to do, and everything will follow in sequence, and some of that will wrap itself around these messages. But what's important is I had to scrap that. I had to absolutely scrap that. At the last minute, the Lord gave me this message and said I needed to preach this. So I'm going to preach it. I put on Facebook this. And we're changing into a different atmosphere now, a different space now. There's a different realm of glory settling upon us now. It's a different sound that's coming out. Amen? Oh, yeah, that's lovely. God's busy shifting, changing. Be sensitive to the Spirit while I'm speaking. I put this on Facebook. When you know who you are and what you are called to do, then you know what you have. In other words, when you know who you are and what you are called to do, you can place value on the right things. Does that make sense? When people don't know who they are, most often, this might sound strange to you, but do you know that most of the people that I've spoken to over the many years that I've been a pastor have not always known who they are until they hit their late 30s, early 40s? And you might find that it's strange. But when we think we know who we are, only when we get into our mid-30s do we realize, hang on, I didn't know who I was. And that's not for everybody. Some people find their way much earlier, but I'm just generalizing. And I believe why that is because there's so many restrictions placed on us. Either it's the job we're in and we kind of float into some kind of career move and you get stuck and lodged in a specific way of doing things, a way of life, or a partnership or relationship that kind of you just... things just happen. Life just happens. And before you know it, you realize you've been living your life to please everybody else. As that's what happens when you're younger, because there's so much manipulation around in the world. Amen. Is that true? Anybody here this morning? I need your help this morning. Can anybody give me a good amen? Amen. And that means so be it. And that means we stand in agreement. And the moment you agree with the word of God, you bring it into your sphere. Hallelujah. And so this is a reality for people. And people come and they say, I don't know who I am. I don't even know what I'm supposed to do. I've been doing this all my life. And so we come to a crossroads always, it seems, at the wrong time. You'd like to say, Lord, couldn't you, when I'm 21 or when I'm 18 and I leave school, kind of show me those ropes before I hit the 35 mark, you know? You've heard little kids, they stand up and they say, what you say to them, what do you want to be when you grow up? And they'll say, I want to be a doctor, or I want to be a surgeon, or a firefighter, or whatever it is, something really dramatic and something that usually sounds like it's going to make an impact in the world, right? And I wonder if we really looked at the statistics, how many of us, when we were kids, said something like that, and we've all grown up and we just flowed into something else. Life just happened. We got offered a job opportunity then, so we took it, and so that's where we gained experience, and so that's where we moved into, and it just became a career. We got into a relationship when we were very young and didn't realize, you know, the full extent of it not being maybe the right relationship. Maybe it is the right relationship for many of us, and just you get stuck in a rut. Is that true? Yeah. And so those are some of the reasons. Some of us have been in a place where we've always felt the pressure to please our parents, to please our siblings, to please our friends, to just please everybody else except ourselves. Now, I'm not talking about being selfish, okay? Are you with me? But if we do that, the point I'm making is that we never get to discover who we are. So you don't want that to be a selfish move, but when you come into Christ's kingdom, you find your identity in Jesus Christ. You've been taught that, right? And as you find who you are in Jesus Christ, you find your purpose and you find your destiny. And you've heard me talk about this many a time. I've said to you that your job is not your life's work. The problem is when God gives us what we want, when God gives us that good job or gives us that great partner, we end up making that our little G. That becomes the thing we idolize. That becomes the thing we worship. And then we still miss the boat. Amen. Our first love, the highest love, must always be Jesus Christ, so that we have everything in the right order and then everything can work the way it's supposed to. Because God is the creator of all things. And who knows you better than the one who created you? Amen. But we were given such great brains when God created us that we think we know better than God sometimes. Is that true too? It's a true story. Okay, I'm getting some response. Some of you are beginning to warm up. So when you know who you are and what you are called to do, then you know what you have. Because I don't believe people can have a true heart of gratitude for the things that God gives them unless they really know who they are and where they are going and their purpose. Hallelujah. Because all those other things are noise that get in the way when you, before you discover who you are in Christ. I'm not saying you don't have gratitude before then, but I believe we cannot fully realize and have hearts of gratitude and really know and understand what we have or place value on the right things until we are in the right position, the right place with Christ, and until we have found who we are and where we stand and where we are positioned, where we fit in. Hallelujah. Because you don't place value above that which you value in your own life, right? Do you know what I'm saying? So if you don't even value yourself, you'll probably not value people very highly. Come on, I'm preaching to you. Is that true? But if you start to get value, how do you get value? It's not just through somebody giving you a nice pep talk or a motivational message. That's the other thing. It's so sad for me. So many churches today, they appear to have all the right things, the right lights. You know, they sing the right songs. Listen to me, I'm telling you something now. They sing the right songs. And some of them even fill up. But they fill up with the wrong things. The Spirit of God is absent from the meetings. So you see people walk in and walk out the same way. All they hear is a motivational message. Do you know how easy it is to prepare a motivational message? We want a message that carries power. I want what I tell you to impact your life. Why? Because what we're talking about is the supernatural realm of God. Transformation is not something you're going to get in the flesh. You can work out things yourself. You can transform many things yourself. You can have all those New Year's resolutions all worked out that will only last for a month, if that. But you in your own strength cannot be all that you've been called to do and be and reach your full potential unless you let the supernatural work of Christ begin to operate in your life. Do you know what that means? It means letting your guard down. It means being vulnerable. And it means absolutely trusting God with all that you have. Amen? And in order to do that, you need to heal. And that's why we have such a three words. You'll see it on the top of our website. You'll see it on our banners. Saved, healed, whole. We believe those are the three components to restoration. Hallelujah, because God is restoring the church. So many people get saved, and then they stay in the church, but they never really get healed. And so they never really get whole. And none of those three words comes except by supernatural means. You don't accept and receive a Christ that you see. You receive and accept a Christ into your heart that you do not see. So why do some people let the divine work of Christ allow that into their lives? But when we talk about the rest of the supernatural, people turn a blind eye. They go, oh no, then that can't be. But I've accepted Christ into my heart, right? So how did I do that? Christ's not physically sitting here with us. We've got to come to a place, friends, that to value the right things in life, to live in this place that God has called us, we've got to know who we are and we've got to know our purpose. And I need to tell you this morning that you are called with divine intention. I'll see if I get to it, but there's a story I'm going to tell you about three or four different people in the Word of God: David, Moses, Esther, and Joshua, and maybe one other. But we'll see if we can get to one of them, David, this morning. But I just want to read from Matthew 22 with you right now. Our key scripture, by the way, if you're taking notes, which I strongly suggest, is in Romans 8:28, which you all know well. Amen. But right now, first turn with me to Matthew 22, and we're going to read verses 1 to 14. Okay. From verse 1, Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come. But they refused to come." Are you listening to this? "Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who've been invited, Then I've prepared my dinner. My oxen, my fatted calves and cattle have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But they paid no attention and went off. One to his field, another to his business. You know, this is a very powerful parable, friends. The Bible says, and this is what Jesus is telling the story of this parable, the king was enraged. He sent his army and he destroyed those murderers and he burned up their city. And then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited, they didn't deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite the banquet. Invite to the banquet anyone you can find. So the servants went out into the streets and they gathered all the people they could find. Listen to this, the bad as well as the good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. Just let's stop there for a moment. You know, it's so incredible for me. The word says that many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. And that's verse 14. As we read a little bit further, you'll see in the story. Many are called, but few are chosen. What does that mean? Many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. If we look at this parable of the banquet, what we see is that Jesus is explaining it. There's so many different stories you can take out of this. But Jesus is saying, the ones that I did invite were not interested. So you know what? I opened up the banquet that anybody could come. Anybody was invited. The bad, the good, everyone. The people that were invited did not appreciate what they were being invited to. Amen? There was almost a spirit of familiarity. I see that even among sometimes the people of God, there's a spirit of familiarity. People don't know how much they've got or how good they have it until they don't have it anymore. Amen? And I want to tell you right now, I look at this house of God and I know what sweat, blood, and tears has been poured into this house by all of my team and myself and the people that have helped in this house, that have been part of building this house. Amen? And I say there are so many that don't recognize and know what they have in this house. They've been invited, but they don't come. It's there. It's just there. If I want to go, I can go. Amen? Yeah. Or it becomes familiar. It's familiar. Unless a person knows who they are, let me come back. Unless a person knows who they are in Christ, they cannot recognize a value that would be placed on the house of Christ. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We don't recognize this. Friends, God has opened the banquet for all of us to come. God has not discriminated on any level. The banquet, the house of the Lord, the feast, the wedding feast is here for the bride to come. The bride of Christ, the people of God have been ushered in. But the ones that have been invited didn't come. You could relate that to the Jewish nation. When Christ had invited the very ones to whom he belonged, the very tribe to which he belonged, the Jewish nation, they didn't recognize him. There was a spirit of familiarity. The Pharisees turned around and they said, isn't that the carpenter's son? What do you mean he's doing miracles? And they even cursed the city that he came from. They said, what good can come from? Hallelujah. Because there was not a level of faith, because they didn't value the right things, because they weren't in the right place, they weren't positioned correctly, and they weren't in a place that they were called to. They weren't honoring where God had put them. They weren't living out who they were called to be. When you're living out who you're called to be, you recognize the things in the spirit realm. You recognize what God has given you. When you're not living out what you're called to be, the devil is busy filling your mind with other stuff. He's busy putting everything in your mind and everything in your midst to distract you from the purposes of God, from the plans of God, from the directive over your life. Yet God says, I've created you with divine intention. Divine intention. You are intentionally created. The earth was intentionally created for human beings to reside. Many are called, but few are chosen. Many were called. Many were invited. But only the few came. And they were the supposed renegades. They were the ones that were left out. They were the remnant. Many are called, but few are chosen. Why? Because it's only the ones that recognize who they are called to be, what their purpose is, and who they are in Christ, that recognize the value of what God has put inside them, that are the ones that fulfill their calling and stay the course. I said, the Word of God says, many are called, but few are chosen. Those are Jesus' words. There are so many people that have been called into the kingdom of God, who have put things, have valued other things, carnal things, higher than they valued their calling. For example, someone might put a job higher than they value the calling of God in their lives. Their life's work is your calling. Someone might put a partner higher than they value their calling. Friends, it doesn't matter whether you're married, whether you're partnered, no matter what's going on, you have to walk in the calling God has for you to be prosperous and to be an inheritor of all that God has for you. And more than that, for you to be used effectively in the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? It's the sphere of influence that you bring wherever you go, into your workplace, into your friendships, wherever. I've always taught my people this much, and I've taught all of you this. If you go into a dark place, are you supposed to be the light or are you supposed to look like the rest of the darkness? We're salt and light. So nobody says don't mix with the world or go into the world. What we're saying is your challenge is if you go, you better be ready to be salt and light. Otherwise, don't go. If you cannot go into a dark place and not and be salt and light because you're too busy worried about what they think of you, because you're too busy worried about being accepted and liked, then you need healing so that God can restore you to your original intent, which was to be a kingdom seeker, a pursuer of righteousness, somebody that values the things of God higher than the opinions of people. Friends, let me tell you something. When we look at the story of David, and I'm going to go back there later, but there was a point in David's life where as he was still a young man and it came time to fight Goliath, and he was in the right place at the right time because David was a follower of God. In fact, the Bible says that he was a person, a man after God's own heart, right? We all know that. But the thing about David was that because of that, he was positioned correctly for the right time for his calling. And when he had to go and fight Goliath, Saul was he had so much favor with Saul that he was given Saul's armor to put on. Saul said, here's my armor, put this on. And David put the armor on and he said, I can't wear this. This is weighing me down. I'll never be able to kill the giant with this on. Why? Because that armor was made for Saul. It wasn't made for David. But if David was a people pleaser, if David wasn't living in knowing who he was and being called to be where he was supposed to be, and he was trying to please people, he might very well have said, oh, shame, you know, it's Saul. I don't want to make him unhappy. And, you know, let me just wear this armor and I'll try and pick up those stones without falling over because it's so heavy, right? I'll pick up the stones and then I'm sure I can. No, he didn't. He didn't do that. He also did not try to be somebody else by trying to wear someone else's armor to please them or to please the world or to be like someone else. You were created with divine intent. You were created to be exactly who you are, but with an additional little note in Christ. In Christ. And that means you are born not just into this world as a human being with a name. I nearly said a blob, but I didn't mean a blob. I mean, you know, here we are. We substance. We are tangible. But you were born with a divine intention, divine purpose over your life. And so long as the enemy, we call him the enemy because he is, because the Bible says he's come to kill, steal, and destroy. As long as he is stealing and destroying from you, he'll end up killing you. Yeah. Listen to me. Because when you lose hope for the vision that God has for your life, or you haven't even got to the place where you can see that vision, he's already got you halfway there. Some of us are busy living in the armor of Saul when we should be walking in our own stuff. Hallelujah. And it's so heavy that it weighs you down. You cannot live to please people, even our parents. Friends, some of us have grown up in such oppressive circumstances that we have all we've understood is people manipulating us. We didn't know that's what it was called at the time. Amen. But you just go with the flow so that you end up finding that your partners are like that. You end up finding that you let everyone manipulate you in life because there's a spirit that comes over you with that. And so only when you get free and you start realizing who you are in Christ, those things, that spirit of manipulation has no more hold on you. And you see things for what they are, and all of a sudden, if it's your family, they turn around and they go, how can you say that to me? How can you just... Because it doesn't have that effect on you anymore. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Listen, these things are real. Now, I'm not saying that about every family. I'm just saying that it's that whole perpetual cycle, our grandparents, our parents, and so it goes on, and it affects everything in our lives until we come to that place where we say, listen, no more. I'm not being manipulated. I'm not being pulled so that this heaviness weighs upon me. I'm going to stand in who I'm called to be. I'm created with a divine intention, and I need to find out what that is. And many of you are on the road to discovering that. Some of you are on the road to, you are there already, and you're now busy walking the road that God has for you. But there are many people that just come to church and found themselves still stuck in the mud. And I want to tell you, I believe it's because you haven't found your intentional, divine, intentional purpose. God has this intentional purpose for you. And God's got a unique fingerprint for everyone, and you're not supposed to fit into Saul's armor. God has armor that is designed specifically for you to fight the giant, to slay the giants that come in your path. Amen. And not just that. It's not just to fight this war and be exhausted about fighting the spiritual war and these devils and all these things. You know, Apostle, we're so tired of hearing about devils. We want to hear the good things. Yes, of course. That's what your divine intention is. You first get rid of the devils. Hallelujah. And then you walk in the promise. And then wherever you walk, wherever you put your feet, you change the atmosphere around you. You don't let people pull you down. You don't let people pull you into a pit. You tell them, listen, I've just come out of there. Do you think I'm going to go back in there? No. You don't let people pull you in a pit. Hallelujah. And friends, those of you that are married or have partners or whatever, you need to realize, please don't misinterpret what I'm saying. Okay? I'm not saying go into rebellious mode against your wives or your husbands or your partners. I'm saying pursue what God has for your life, because it will always bring you together as a couple. It will never pull you apart. Amen. Hallelujah. And if you're pursuing what God has for you in your life, and each of you realize that you don't need to unhealthily hang on to each other and not serve God because you're so scared of losing each other, that you like, oh, that's fear. Fear is not born of God. Hallelujah. God has got so much more for your relationship. God wants you together to be a force to be reckoned with. That when people see your testimony of where you've come from, where you've been, and where you are now, and where you are going, their ears will prick up and listen, because they can see the power of God in your life moving, because you were created with divine intention. Tell your neighbor, I'm created with divine intention. Now tell your neighbor, the other one, you're created with divine intention. Isn't that good news? They paid no attention. The one went off into his field and the other went off into his business. Do you know what happens when we don't have God's purpose in mind, when we don't know the value that God places on us, we place value on the wrong things first. In other words, it's not that our jobs are not valuable, or it's not that our spouses are not valuable. God forbid, right? It's the order in which we value. I said placing value on the right things. So we want God to be the first thing, to take the highest place, like we sang earlier. My soul longs for. That's what David was. He was called a man after God's heart because his what he desired, he wrote so many of the Psalms. Because when you read those Psalms, there's an intimacy, there's a connection with God that David had. That's what God said. That's why God said, this man is a man after my heart. Because he longed for one thing above everything else. And that was the presence of the mighty God. He hungered for it. And friends, when you've had a taste of it, how many of you know you long for it? Hallelujah. So if you haven't had a taste, the devil keeps you from that. He tells you, don't listen to that nonsense. That's all supernatural, airy-fairy nonsense. And I tell you right now, it doesn't matter what background you come from. If you believe in God, you better believe the God of the whole Bible. And my Bible talks about the book of Acts being a supernatural, revelationary, on fire church. A church that could never have brought the gospel to the whole world unless there was another element called the Holy Spirit. Supernatural element in their midst. And if you know, a religious spirit will keep you from seeing that. If you want to know what a religious spirit is, come to home group. Friends, if you don't attend a home group and you want to start getting your life in that space where your divine intention becomes known, that's the place to be, because that's where you learn about God, and that's where you get to ask questions in a safe, healthy environment, and you can learn more about the Word, and it will help you on your way, and people will come around you and help you. Amen. You can ask anybody, when they start attending home groups, things change for them. Amen. Because the Word on a Sunday sustains you, but it doesn't grow you. You have to be in that secret place on your own for the Spirit to grow you. And then you have to have that divine intention made known to you as you live and breathe the Word of God. Amen? So Jesus was showing, he was saying, listen, this is what the kingdom of God is going to be like at the end of the age. There are going to be people that even though the feast is there, even though they're being called to a banquet. What is a banquet? It's a feast for a king, right? It's a banquet. You put out a banquet for important people, right? And yeah, Jesus is saying to them, listen, in the end times, this is what it's going to be like. I'm putting out a banquet of my presence. I'm putting out a banquet of my love. But yet, even if people are invited, they don't want to come. They don't want to come. So I tell you what, let me focus on the people that do want to come. Let me focus on the people that want to be in my house, the people that want my presence, the people that are hungry to be at my banqueting table. Listen, the Bible says that Christ, that God has prepared a table for you in the midst of your enemies. Listen, where the enemy is showing you absolute devastation, God is showing you a banquet. A banquet. I'm telling you. And you can see, you know, we as a church, as a team, and as leaders, everybody, we spoke about it last week. That's why I was stirring your faith last week. That's what last week was about, was just to stir our faith. Because, you know, we come out of a very tough year. Most of us have had how many of you have had a very absolutely perfect 2014? Don't show the camera that, right? How many of you can say that I need to have 2015's got to be a better year? So there must be some hope in you, right? But you're not going to hope for what you see. You hope for what you do not see. You're certain, when, as a Christian, faith is being certain of what you cannot see. In Hebrews 11:1, right? And that's the area that we've got to grow. Now, we grew tremendously in 2014 because we too were affected. As a church, as individuals, we went through some very difficult experiences as families. Hallelujah. Many of us experienced a very, very difficult time. Some of us shared and some of us didn't. Come on, I'm telling you. How many know it's better to share than not to share? Come on. That's part of our growth, is to trust others. You know, I tell everybody that, right? It's not because you want everyone to know your business. It's about learning to trust in a healthy way. Will you be let down? Maybe. But we've got to start somewhere. So 2014 was a difficult year, but you know what the Lord showed us? We were talking early on the way in the car, saying to Prophet Jacques, because he was in Cape Town, and He had a lovely holiday. Welcome back, Prophet Shark. God's busy speaking to him and speaking to all of us in new ways. But we were just sharing with him, you know, while he was away. We had a Job experience. And especially over November, December, what a Job experience it was. And we don't preach doom and gloom in the church. We're not trying to make it drab. But it was a very difficult time. There was huge spiritual warfare over our church, especially when I go and I fulfill the apostolic calling and mantle that I have and I start preaching in the churches. There's always an attack on this local body. I don't know why. You can ask my team. That's not a coincidence either. Amen. So when we came back in July, when we came back in October, there was always drama. The enemy always tries to stir. But you know, God is greater and bigger. And what we said is that what is amazing is, yes, we've had some very hectic Job experiences, and even with this new house of the Lord. But I can tell you something. God has brought us to our knees because of it. And so listen, friends, how many know, you know, your hearts can get hard, eh? Our hearts can get hard. Calloused. And so when you come into prayer and things happen in your life, God just begins to stir you and move you a little bit and shake you a bit. And it's not that God brings those things on. God may allow them. God doesn't bring them on. Okay? Often it's our own wrong decisions. We're just quick to blame everyone. Amen. But often it's our own wrong decisions. It's not God. And so, but in this case, we were just in a Job place. And God was just stirring our hearts. And you know what? It made us even stronger to stand. And I want to tell you something, that when you discover, friends, when you discover and you understand your intentional calling, your divine calling, and you walk in it, you get stronger and stronger and stronger. But that banquet also represents divine callings. And so for many people, even people that have walked in that door, they've had divine callings in this house, and they've decided to walk away from the banquet. I'm telling you, it's sad. It's a terrible thing. Because then God's got to raise up another generation, and that takes time. It takes time to raise up people. When you've poured your life into people, it takes time. And so what separates? What makes it different? What makes me stand and others not? What makes you stand and others not? Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because many will come to the banquet. Many will be invited to the banquet. But many will not come. Many will not come on the journey when it gets tough. Many will not be on the road when they have to start building. Many will give up before they hit the hard part. Oh, this is too hard. Oh, listen, I can only go that far up the mountain. You can't take me. This isn't Everest. I can't go up to the peak. That's just too far. God knows our hearts. And God knows what we can endure. But friends, half of that stuff, half of us saying no, half of us not coming to the banquet, half of those things is because we're not healed. And so the fears of life overtake us, and they stop us moving into the promises of God. And we live in a perpetual cycle, a balance that is not created by God. It's an imbalance. It's not even a balance. And we think it's life, and we think it's our lot, and we think that's the straw we've drawn, and that's how it's supposed to be. And it's a lie from the pit of hell. You were created with divine intention, and God has so much more for you and for me. And I believe it. And I don't stand here today sacrificing as much as I have, and as much as Prophet has, and as much as many of you have sacrificed. We don't sit here and sacrifice all these things because we just want to be martyrs for the kingdom. I can do without that. Hallelujah. It's because we believe in what God said. God said it, and we believe it, no matter what it looks like. I don't care if the table looks empty when you walk in. If God said there's a banquet, you better believe it's a banquet. And it's coming. It's coming. But you have to stop getting your mind in the way. You got to see it with your spirit. You got to begin to let loose. You got to begin to let the spirit of control out of your sphere. Oh, it's so nice and relaxing when you do that. We think it's like such a good thing, and it's actually such a stressful thing to keep up appearances. My gosh. How many of you are just so tired of that? You were created with divine intention. That means that God has specifically laid out a plan for your life. Each of you, different plan. Yes, do they all meet in the middle? Of course, because it's Christ. Hey? But it's a different plan. Jesus speaks about this parable and says this is how it's going to be in the ages to come. When those invited refused to come, some refused because they were too busy and others because they had their worldly pursuits in mind before God. The only time we put things that are worldly pursuits above God is when we don't know what we have. Can you see how I'm getting back to what I said? Are you hearing me? The devil wants to keep you from seeing what you have in Christ. But this morning, the Lord wants you to see the banquet table and to say, you're all invited. You're part of this. You're part of this great work. You're part of all that God. God has so much more for you than the lot that you think you've been given. Will you pursue? Will you pursue what God has for you? Will you be? You've all been invited. Now, will you come? Will you come? The banquet is walking in the pursuit of the life that God has for you. Coming to the table means you're joining hands with the family of God. Christ is at the head of the table. Are you hearing me? Oh, I don't know. I want to tell you something else. This can be likened, you know, to the four soils that we speak about in the Gospels. Matthew 13 is always the one I use. Where some people hear, but they don't take it in. Amen? And friends, we have to be hearers. We have to be hearers. We've got to hear and say, you know what? If I'm invited, I am running there. If I'm invited, I'm running there because I know what awaits me. I know what it means to have lived life out there in the darkness. I know what it means to be down and kicked. I know what it is to have everything taken from me. But I am going where there is life now. I'm going to pursue life. And the moment I'm invited, I'm there. What changed? What changed from the person that was invited but never came? The devil kept you from seeing, or the devil kept them from seeing what they had. So when you come and you stay in Christ and you position yourself in Christ, you're able to see clearly what you have, and you value the right things in the right order. Are you with me? And so we've got to understand that we've got to be hearers of the word, and we've got to receive that word with joy. We can't be those that hear the word and then it doesn't take root, so it only lasts a short time. And the moment trouble comes, we lose our faith, we fall off the bus, we catch a wobbly, and then we start again and we move on from the elementary things and we start being Hebrew 6 people. No, I don't want to be a Hebrew 6 people, not the first three paragraphs. Go and read it. Go and read it. If you're finding yourself in that cycle and circle, get healing. That's all. We just need healing. And healing sometimes takes time. Amen? And we will only heal as we're open to it. And let me tell you, this banquet is also likened to the parable that Jesus spoke about in Matthew 7 when he said, there's a broad gate and a narrow gate. And in the broad gate, many will enter that gate. But the narrow gate, few will come. What is the narrow gate? It's the gate that leads to life. But why will few come? Yes, it leads to purpose. Why will few come? Because it is not just easy to walk a road of purpose. It does require faith. It does require sacrifice. There is a cost. There are times where your friends will laugh at you. oh, you're one of those happy clappies. Oh, you're in this whole goody two-shoes God thing now. Oh, yes, I am. And it's the most trendy thing I could do. There's no other way I want to be. Because you know what you have. You have an understanding spiritually of what you have. What's at stake? And that's what God wants for you to see this morning, is what you have. The devil wants you to see what you don't have. I'm here this morning to tell you and show you what you do have. There's a banquet. You are divinely created with intentional purpose. And the Lord says, there's a banquet. There's a banquet. The ones that came are the ones that heard, and they recognized the importance of that banquet. I recognize the importance of this banquet. That's what I'm doing here. I'm not here to be a martyr. I'm not good at that. That's not my calling. So I will stay true to what God has called me to do, no matter what. Are you hearing me? I pray to God. That's what I do. With my heart, that's what I believe. What about you? Are you walking in right now your destiny, your purpose, your calling, the intentional purpose that God has for your life? Or are you standing on the periphery and saying, you know what, I'm cool here because I can still make decisions I want to make and I don't have to sacrifice. There is no cost. Friends, the cost of not following God is so much bigger. Not because there's a threat of hell and all of that. I mean, you know all those things. But because that's not life. But when you know what you have, you'll come. Amen? I don't know if that's made sense to you this morning. Last scripture, turn with me, Romans 8:28. And we know, read it with me, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those that love God, who have been called according to God's purpose. For God foreknew, God also predestined. To be what? Conformed to the image of God's Son. That he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. And you read a bit further on in verse 31, and it says, if God be for us, who can be against us? And there are times we walk around thinking God's not for us. And this is such a powerful, powerful, powerful scripture. We know that in all things God works for the good of those that love God. For those that were predestined for purpose of God. Let's look just for a moment at that. The first thing I want you to notice, friends, is that you must finish what you start. If you want to be a person that lives in your divine intention, you must finish what you start. In 2 Timothy 4:7, the word says, I've fought the good fight, worthy and honorable, noble fight, and I've finished the race, and I've kept the faith. God works for the good of all things. But to work for the good of all things, my friends, we have to walk the path that God gives us. You see, the problem with so many grace ministries today is what they do is they speak out this grace message, which we believe, right? All of us, the grace message, but without any consequence. So in other words, you can do almost what you like and there's no consequence because you're under grace. How does that work? How does that work? Here's the thing, if we make mistakes, we're under grace. But there's still a consequence. Listen, when David made Bathsheba pregnant, the consequence was that even though he confessed his sin, she still was pregnant. And the baby died, obviously. But do you know what I'm saying? She still was pregnant. For God works for the good of those that love God and for the divine purpose for which people have been created. But we have to walk in the will of God. We've got to walk in the intentional creation that we have been given in Christ. We have to start. We have to finish what we start. We have to be people that finish well. We have to be people that are not afraid for those to mock us, or that we are not swayed. Listen, Ephesians 4:11 speaks about why the fivefold ministry are there. Why are the apostles, prophets, and teachers, and pastors, and evangelists in the house of the Lord? Why? Because they are there to equip the saints so that people won't blow like chaff in every direction, this way or that way. And that's what I'm saying to you this morning. When you are founded and grounded in your intentional, the intentional creation that you were made for, and you are a person living in that, you know who you are, you know where you're going, and you know what you have. No one can sway you from that. What makes me different from those that have fallen? Nothing else but that. I know who I am, I know where I'm going, and I know what I have. I understand this banquet, the presence of God. I understand that. That's the only thing that makes me different and makes you and I different. You are different when you understand the intentional purpose for which you created. And then you know that Romans 8:28 says, God works for the good of those that love God. Hallelujah. So the second point is that you, in order to live in that life, you must pursue God's will and purpose regardless of what people think. You are not concerned about what people think of you. Amen? The Pharisees were more interested in the praises from people than what God was telling them. They were more interested in what people thought than what God thought. And that's the other thing. You want to talk about staying power? You want to talk about living in intentional purpose? It's just not being afraid of what people think. It's doing what you know is right above everything else. Not being swayed and blown like chaff. That's double-mindedness, James says. It's double-mindedness. Never knowing which way, because you don't know who you are. You're this way, you're that way, Somebody says this and you run off in that direction. Someone says this, you run off in that direction. Influenced by every little thing that people are saying. Influenced, but by your actions are influenced by how they perceive you and see you. Then you do things that please people. Are you with me? Know who you are. Know where you're going. And know what you have. Amen? And the third thing is being a worshiper. I should have put that first. John 4:23 says, a time will come. Indeed, it is already here when the true, genuine worshipers will worship God the Heavenly Parent in spirit and in truth. That means in reality. For the parent is seeking such people as these that are worshipers. That's the other secret, if you want to call it a secret. Those three points. The first thing is drawing into that place. Get around that banqueting table. Link arms with those you're in fellowship with. And get into the presence. Get into that place, that posture of worship. Your first course of action is your prayer life and reading the word. If you can't, if that is where you're being pulled from, that's where you need healing. Amen? Created with divine intention. Isn't that powerful? It's powerful to know. The devil's got some people running in that direction, running all over the show. And all you need to do is come to the banquet this morning. Come to the table. It's a table of mercy, and it's a table that's been prepared even in the midst of your enemies. The enemy cannot touch you. He lies to you. He pulls you apart. When you leave the church the rest of the week, you have to live in reality of what's there. And you might be saying, you know, Pastor, you don't know what's going on in my life. You don't know what I've got to deal with. And, you know, you don't know. I don't. But God does. And if we serve the same God, then if that God is consistent, then God will come through for you. Amen? And I believe that with everything I am. God will come through for you. So I want every head bowed. And as we play a song, I want you to, if you're feeling led to come to this table this morning, this isn't the communion table, but it's a table of communion. It's a table where you come and you link hands with the God that you serve. And you say, Lord, here I am. fill me with more of you, Jesus. Show me my path in life, that I know who I am, that I know where I'm going, and that I know what I have. Show me, Lord, to see with eyes in the spirit, not eyes of the flesh. Supernaturally endow me. And then I'm just going to lay hands on you this morning. Just pray over you right now. Whatever it is that you need, it'll be healing, whatever. I'm not going to linger this morning. I'm just going to touch your heads and move on. So I just want you to know that the Spirit of God is here. So just come up as you feel led and let Holy Spirit touch you. Just come into that place of purpose again. If you've lost your purpose, if you've lost your focus, maybe you're just saying, Lord, I need that touch, that additional touch of your fire in me to move into what you've called me to be. Then come up this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. Holy Spirit, touch. Pushakabata.
We hope you have been blessed by this message. Join Pastor Deborah next week for another exciting word.
Jesus, Fill her, Lord, power, shukura, purpose, shukura, valued in Jesus' name, highly valued in Jesus' name.